Okay, hello again. And for those of you who do not know me, my name is Vladimir Fricks, and I'm a physician practicing in Southwest Portland. In our clinic, we have been in practice for more than 20 years, pretty much devoting our time to diagnosis and treatment of pain syndromes. I practice in a team environment. Together with physician assistants, Bridget Lam and Dmitry Shur. And we share our patients in terms of how we evaluate them, how we try to help them, and work pretty much elbow to elbow in trying to help people. What I would like today to do today What I would like to do today, I'm sorry, I did not turn my camera, but right now it should be on. What I would like to do today is to discuss in more or less general terms about pain, what kind of disease it is, and also different presentations of pain, because not all of it is the same. Important topics of narcotic medications and how they are applied in treatment of chronic pain, as well as a very common treatment option, which is different type of injections, what kind of injections we can do and why we do them, as well as more advanced treatments such as neuromodulations. There are going to be an opportunity to ask some questions, and hopefully it will generate some interest and some discussion later on. So pain is a symptom that most commonly is the reason why people come to their doctors. It's something that affects people individually. It also affects them on a societal level. Obviously, based on what you see on the slide, it's something that cost our society quite a bit of money. Interestingly, most of the pain problems tend to affect people a little bit later in life, in the middle ages. But what is pain? Not all pain is the same. Generally, pain is defined as an experience. Experience, obviously unpleasant, that has to do with tissue damage or has to do with perceived tissue damage. Usually, our basic understanding of what happens when somebody experiences pain is that there is some sort of irritation of a peripheral pain receptor that generates a signal that travels through the nerves, through the spinal cord, to the brain, where it gets analyzed. Most of the time, those type of signals in the periphery are generated by some sort of injury. It can be mechanical injury, it can be chemical injury, or it can be injury that has to do with burn or thermal injury. Now, acute pain is very different from chronic pain. As you may probably realize, in acute situations, pain is designed by your body to let you know that there is something wrong and you should pay attention to it. And a lot of acute pain syndromes can resolve spontaneously or with some treatment. However, in a time frame of about 3 to 6 months, if pain does not go away and becomes chronic, it can become a disease by itself. And that's when we should address it in a little bit different way. Not all pain is the same. Some pain is intermittent. It has to do with specific mechanical issues. It may be only present in certain positions or related to a specific diseases which generate pain only, for example, with weight bearing. Classical example of this type of situation would be pain associated with arthritis in the weight bearing joints, such as knee or hip. However, spinal stenosis is another good example of intermittent mechanical pain, because it's usually associated with standing position or people experience discomfort while walking. Another entity is a neuropathic pain. This is pain that usually is generated from within the neural system that has to do with nerve damage, either peripheral nerve or central nervous system. It tends to be constant pain. It tends to last for a long time, may not go away easily, may require significant treatment efforts, and usually gets worse with activity, but does not go away at rest. So this list of common pain conditions by no means is supposed to be exhaustive. However, it gives you an opportunity to see some of the diseases with which we deal with on a day-to-day basis in a pain clinic environment. By far, the most common presentation of patients coming to the pain clinic is spinal pain. Spinal pain in all sorts of presentation, in all sorts of forms. Very common disc injuries, very common some nerve pain, or other peripheral nerve injuries and persistent pain related to the nerve irritation or some type of compression following surgery or following injury of different kind. Very common presentation to the pain clinic is low back pain. Low back pain is a general entity which obviously has a lot of different presentation. First of all, it's very common. It can be something that it bothers people after just a weekend activity. However, it can also be something that lives with people for a long time after multiple surgeries and multiple experiences of frustrating and unsuccessful treatment options. Low back pain can be quite complex. It can be due to a variety of reasons. And sometimes not all of those reasons can be actively discerned. However, some pain can be limiting and can resolve on its own, especially pain that occurs in like a muscle spasm that can occur after some sports activity or let's say weekend gardening activity. Other types of low back pain can be quite intractable and require multiple treatment options and significant evaluation. Now, low back pain does not always associate with specific imaging findings, even though when those are present, obviously the disease is more difficult, is more easy to evaluate. However, if somebody has a normal MRI but significant low back pain, does not mean that there is no legitimate reason for them to have pain. It just may require a little bit more evaluation. Not always low back pain is associated with radiating back pain. Sometimes pain may be present just in the low back area, and it just means that that it may be related to different anatomical structures rather than specific nerve. Low back pain may require multiple treatment options, and usually we start with conservative approach and proceed to a more advanced approach depending on patient response. Now, sciatica pain is a little bit more defined because it usually is related to a specific nerve. Most of the time, a nerve arising through and from lower lumbar levels. The medical term for sciatica is lumbar decubapathy. And most of the time, it's related to irritation of the nerve related to the disc problem, either disc herniation or disc disruption. Sciatica pain tends to be sharp, tends to be aching and throbbing. The people present with sciatica pain quite common. This is a more of an acute pain situation and can respond very well to spinal injections, especially when administered on time. Another common presentation of patients in a pain clinic is persistent knee pain, not only due to end-stage joint disease, but also sometimes following a total knee replacement. Unfortunately, in that particular location, patients may continue on to have pain after the joint replacement. There is published approximately 15% of cases when people do continue to have pain for at least 5 years. In a variety of ways, knee pain can be successfully treated conservatively through intra-articular injections or some non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medications or other medications. But if patients don't respond, Other more advanced treatment options are available, such as radio frequency ablation, injection of white rich plasma or bone marrow concentrate, and peripheral or dorsal ganglion stimulation. The reason why I mentioned all of it to you is because I need you to know that even though you may have had supposedly definitive procedures such as joint replacement, but continue to have pain, there is no reason to get frustrated, because other treatment options may be available, it could be helpful. Peripheral neuropathy is another common reason for patients to present to pain clinic. There are multiple peripheral neuropathies, very common one related to diabetes, sometimes to irritation of the nerves related to chemotherapy or other toxic substances. Very many cases of peripheral neuropathy just do not have a known etiology, and they're called so-called idiopathic peripheral neuropathy. Nevertheless, the lower extremity peripheral neuropathy is much more common than upper extremities. It usually presents with so-called stacking or glove distribution. The pain tends to be neuropathic, as we discussed a little bit ago. It tends to be sharp, it tends to be stinging, and throbbing. Suffice to say that peripheral neuropathy can be treated fairly effectively with medications and other more advanced treatment options, which we will discuss a little bit later in this presentation. In general, conditions in related to chronic pain can be treated in a variety of ways. We usually start with more conservative options, because obviously we would like to recommend treatment options that have the least amount of potential side effects or complications. Physical therapy, DENS unit, some over-the-counter pain medications can be helpful, as well as cognitive therapy. However, if patients don't respond, we may move to a little bit more advanced procedures and a little bit more stronger medications. And finally, there are more of advanced procedures. Not all of them are listed here, but this just gives you an impression of what is available and how we usually go about it. Again, starting with conservative options and moving to second tier or third tier procedures, depending on patient's response. Now, our discussion would be remiss without talking a little bit about narcotic medications. As you all probably here now, opioids have done quite a bit of damage for patients individually and in the societal level, causing significant side effects. And the truth is that from scientific standpoint, chronic opioid therapy has never been shown to be effective. However, having said that, variety of opinions exist, and patients definitely present with a desire to take some sort of opioid, especially in conditions that do not have other non-opioid treatment options available to them, or they fail. In general, in pain clinic environment, treatment with opioids is considered to be reasonable as long as patient show functional benefit, they follow prescription guidelines, and don't show any significant side effects. Of course, risks have to be discussed and realized, because taking even small amount of opioids still can make patients physically dependent. And if that's something they don't desire, opioids is probably not the best approach. However, in other conditions where there is no solution, it may be acceptable to go with realization that physical dependence is possible, but if opioids later on in life are no longer needed, or there is a desire to taper them off, it's possible as well. Opioids are not the only medications we utilize for treatment of pain conditions. We also utilize so-called adjuvant medications. The most important ones of those are used in neuropathic pain conditions. These medications can be quite effective for neuropathic pain, such as peripheral neuropathy or even sciatica situations, gabapentin, lyrica, as long as they're well tolerated and can show significant improvement, they're justified in using. What we consider success in treatment with neuropathic pain medications is when patients are able to decrease their symptomatology at least 50% with no significant side effects present. However, if medications are not of significant help, we have to frequently move to other treatment options. And the most common treatment options utilized, at least in the initial stages in pain clinic, are different sorts of injections. Now, not all the injections are the same. Some injections are done for diagnostic reasons, for example, to correlate some of the imaging findings for patient presentation. And as long as injection is target specific, as long as it's guided by image, either ultrasound or X-ray, and as long as the amount of injectate is very small, so it can be confined to a specific anatomical target, this injection can be quite diagnostic and can be very helpful in trying to understand patient condition. Other injections, more therapeutic, are available as well. Very commonly, we utilize steroid-based injections. However, other injections can be done as well with split-rich plasma or bone marrow concentrate for therapeutic reasons. In this list, the classic diagnostic injection is a medial branch block, which is a block of a small nerve in the cervical, thoracic, or lumbar spine, which can prognosticate whether a patient is a good candidate for a procedure called radiofrequency ablation. Now, when medications, therapy, injections are not helpful, there are other more advanced treatment options, including surgical options, either minimally invasive surgery or open surgery through neurosurgical means. Most of the time, patients are candidates for surgery when they don't respond to more conservative therapy, when they continue to have persistent symptoms interfering with their quality of life, when there is a situation when they experience neurological deficit, especially progressive neurological deficits such as food drop or loss of bowel or bladder control, as well as some of mechanical issues such as spinal instability. However, not all patients are candidates for surgery. Not always curative or definitive surgical procedure is available, or sometimes it's done but does not deliver on the results promised. So what happens then? If pain does not go away, surgery is not an option, injections, medications, and other conservative modalities such as physical therapy do not work. Well, then we can move on to more advanced treatment options, the most important of which is neuromodulation. Now, within the realm of neuromodulation, there are different procedures, and not all of them are the same. However, suffice to say that neuromodulation has been around for quite some time, and there is a significant experience and body of literature supporting its efficacy. When I talk about neuromodulation, I talk about treatment that is not medication-based. It's well-established because it has been around for many years. It utilizes small amount of electrical current to try to block pain or block painful signal traveling through the spinal cord or a peripheral nerve. You can think about neuromodulation or neurostimulation as the procedure that utilizes a pacemaker to try to suppress pain signal or convert it to more pleasant sensation. The unique feature of neurostimulation is that usually there is a screening procedure available. Now, not all treatment options in medicine have this type of unique feature, and it makes this therapy particularly valuable and useful for treatment because patients have an opportunity to experience what neurostimulation can potentially do for them and make a personalized and educated decision on whether to proceed. Now, during the trial, which usually lasts about 7 to 14 days, patients have an opportunity to experience how this particular device generating small amount of electrical current can potentially suppress the pain signal that they personally experience. The way it works is that a small electrical signal is applied sometimes to towards spinal cord, other times towards peripheral nerve, but the idea is that it can suppress a pain signal or replace it with no sensation at all, or with the sensation of warmth, of a little bit of a buzzing, some sort of non-painful sensation that can be well tolerated. The procedure is performed either under X-ray guidance or under ultrasound guidance. Usually it's done through the needle, therefore it's minimally invasive, there are no incisions. Temporary electrodes, which are very thin leads, are inserted either in the epidural space or wherever peripheral nerve is at, and it's taped to the skin, and patient has an opportunity to try this device and see what it does for them. If this procedure works well, if trial is successful, a patient is recommended to have a permanent system placed. Now, most of the time, our goal with neurostimulation is to reduce pain symptoms for at least 50%. If more, then more. It's very important to see if patients are able, during the time of the trial, to do things that they normally wouldn't have been able to do, such as walk longer, stand longer, sleep through the night, and so forth. If patients are able to reduce or completely eliminate pain medications, that would be a good indication that the trial of this therapy works well. And if so, patients can be offered permanent placement. If permanent placement is an option, it can potentially provide a long-term solution for persistent nerve pain. The best candidates for this type of treatment are patients with neuropathic rather than mechanical pain. Neuropathic pain meaning that majority of patient pain contribution comes from within the neural system, either from a nerve that has been damaged as a result of surgery, or as a result of injury, or for whatever other reason, chemical or thermal. The pain tends to be something that has not responded to other more conservative options, which essentially means that it probably has been lasting for quite some time, usually more than 6 months, and in many cases more than 12 months. This pain is something that interferes with patients' quality of life enough that they are willing to undergo this procedure. And conservative therapy and have been tried and failed, and surgery is either is not an option or has not delivered on results. The most common neurostimulation application or indication in the United States is failback surgery syndrome, which is defined essentially as surgery that appears to be technically successful, but from symptomatic standpoint, did not help patient enough or did not help at all. Now, there are other nerve conditions that are very common for treatment for this particular device, such as complex regional pain syndrome. So this is usually a persistent nerve pain following the injury, or peripheral neuropathy, particularly diabetic neuropathy, as we discussed earlier. Post-surgical pain is a common indication, not just spinal pain, but also other pain in other locations of the body. Now, as I mentioned before, neurostimulation and neuromodulation has been around for many years. Contemporary devices are much more sophisticated than they used to be. Right now, the equipment we have for patients is a very low burden, and it's convenient. It does not really require much. Most of the time, the device that can be used for control of this generator that produces those electrical impulses just looks like an iPhone and can be very familiar and easy to use. Most of the neurostimulation systems are MRI compatible. It would not prevent patients from having MRI study. It's worth mentioning that not all the waveforms generated by spinal cord stimulation or neurostimulation are the same. Some of them are considered to be superior in terms of the efficacy and in terms of patient satisfaction, such as particularly burst DR waveform introduced by Abbott in 2016 has been found to be more effective and received the superiority labeling from FDA. This treatment option has been extensively studied, as you can see on the slide, across 1,000 patients, both for dorsal root ganglion stimulation, which usually is applied for more focal, more peripheral pain, versus dorsal column or spinal cord stimulation, which usually is applied for pain involving larger anatomical areas. As you can see, there are multiple studies listed here. By no means this list is exhaustive, that continue to show efficacy and cost effectiveness of this approach versus other more conservative treatment options that can be tried for years without really significant improvement. Now, is neurostimulation able to cure pain? Unfortunately not. It's more of a palliative procedure, and the design of this treatment and the success of this treatment has to do with successful management of patient symptoms. To allow the patient to return to a reasonable quality of life, the best that can possibly be achieved. Sometimes this can be in combination with other treatment options, not just neurostimulation. However, suffice to say that it can provide long-term management of patient pain by itself or in combination with other treatment options. Most of the time, we look for patients to be able to reduce pain medications. Does that always happen? No. But at least neurostimulation is capable of being a good adjuvant and help other treatment options. If pain medications are one of them, then pain medications to be able to allow patients to continue with their life and needed functionality a little bit more successfully. Now, most of the time, there are no restrictions with neurostimulation. We usually ask patients to limit their bending, stooping type of motion in their spine for the first 4 to 6 weeks following the implant. However, after that, there shouldn't be any restrictions. During the trial, we ask patients to not take shower because we would like to avoid making the dressing wet. But that's only during limited period of time, usually no more than 2 weeks. Now, if patients come back after the trial and have had successful experience and found this treatment to be desirable and wanted, how soon can we go forward with permanent implantation? It really depends on a lot of variables. Obviously, insurance prioritization, but also logistics, whether we are able to proceed with implantation ourselves or whether we need to engage help of another specialist. So all of those things are going to make a difference. In general, on average, I would say the waiting time is no more than 4 to 6 weeks. So in conclusion, what I would like to leave you with is that not all the pain is the same. And the way we evaluate pain, the way we look at it, and the way we proceed with diagnostic algorithm is essentially depending on how patients present, what their pain look like, where exactly it is, and whether it's mechanical versus neuropathic. Now, please understand that even though you may not have had your condition cured, it does not mean that your symptoms may not be successfully managed and you may not be able to return to successful lifestyle, even if your symptoms persist. The potentially effective management is possible and is available. Remember that neurostimulation is a very unique treatment feature because it has a test drive or a screening procedure. Very few, if any, of available treatment in medicine have a screening procedure. Therefore, this makes neurostimulation not only a potential treatment option, but also would allow you to experience this treatment prior to considering whether to stick with it or not. Either way, don't despair, don't get frustrated. If one treatment option does not work, another one may. We most of the time are able to find a combination or a treatment option that is effective, and I think it's very important for you to realize that. I hope this discussion generated some questions. Either way, we would be happy to go ahead and talk to you some more and discuss your particular situation as long as you call us and schedule an appointment. Thank you very much.